As we spend time here in the introduction, we're going to basically focus on five key areas. First, we want to make sure that everybody's got the same foundational understanding of what version control is. You'd be surprised how many people are going to listen to this who either have no information or limited understanding of exactly what problem Git is trying to solve. So before we can understand Git, we've got to understand what it is trying to do. Second, we want to talk about the two ways that a version control tool can be deployed or implemented. Centralized, which is what the traditional tools have done, versus decentralized, which is what Git is going to do, which is quite different. So we want to understand that difference. Thirdly, one of the key elements of version control is parallel development. Some of that's accomplished through branching, but what we want to look at here in the introduction is the other side, the situation where you and I need to affect the same file for roughly the same purpose. And we want to do that without one of us clobbering the other one's work. The fourth topic takes us a little bit deeper under the covers of Git. We want to look at how it stores things because that really impacts some of the functionality we see or the experience we have with Git. And so we're going to do a comparison of, again, the two basic ways the version control tools approach storage, the more traditional deltafied storage versus what Git does with snapshot storage. And then finally, we want to look at Git in a very big picture, understand a little bit about where it came from, where it is today, and what makes it attractive to people. So with that said, let's move on. Version control tools basically have two basic purposes. First, they serve as a historian, and that's what most of us think of them being. They tell us who did what, to what files and folders, when they did that, and what they said about it, which hopefully tells us why they made those modifications. That means we can harvest history to understand how we get to a certain point, as well as we can actually transport ourselves back, a la a time machine, to a point in the past, where we can examine the code to see if an existing problem was still there in that version, roll back to a version, compare versions, all sorts of things that having history available to us provides the capability for us to do. The second purpose is to enable parallel development, and that comes in two flavors. First, we have the traditional situation where we have more than one line of development happening at the same time. The typical example is that we have to put out fixes for the production version that's out. That's of course for companies that have problems in their code that's out there, not yours of course. That means at the same time, we want to be working on a new release, that is new functionality, and maybe it'll include some other types of bug fixes. But the key point is we can't have those cross over. We can't have a half-done feature ending up in production. So we've got to isolate the two work knowing that we want to put it back together again as well. That's traditionally handled by branching, and the same will hold true of Git. The other situation where parallel development comes up, we briefly looked at a moment ago on the outline slide. And that's when you and I want to modify the same file for roughly the same purpose along that same single line of development. How do we provide the capability of doing that without one of us clobbering the work of the other? So we'll look at that in a little more depth in a moment, but that's one of the things version control has to resolve. As we've said, there are two implementation flavors of version control that the tools choose to implement. Centralized is what you've probably experienced with virtually any tool that you've used in version control prior to your choice now of Git. And obviously then, that means distributed is what Git employs. We want to understand that difference, what you're going to experience or what you're going to see different from what you've had in the past. I think it's also important to understand version control in relationship to another term that too often is used as though it is a synonym. That is Software Configuration Management, or SCM. There is no single definition of Software Configuration Management, or SCM, because it really depends on what any particular vendor provides in this area for them to define what SCM is, so it fits what they do. But we can say a few things about it. Beyond just having version control, which is the foundation of SCM, they typically will include build and release management, defect and issue tracking, and various types of process automation. All of those things are beyond what Git itself will provide. Now that's not to say that Git couldn't be a part of a larger SCM solution, but the point is it isn't that by itself. And so when we look at it in Essential Concepts 1 and in Essential Concepts 2 later, we're focused totally on its use as a version control tool. As we look to the approaches to implementing version control, it makes sense to start with the one that you're probably the most familiar with, which is a centralized model, because that's what most of the legacy tools that have been around have been utilizing. In the centralized model, all the history is expected to be put into one repository. Now, that's not to preclude some amount of replication, kind of a master-slave kind of approach. But what it really means is that when we as a user deal with the repository, what we get local is one single revision checked out. That is at least for one experience that we're trying to have with it. We could have multiple of those for different purposes on our machine, but each one is a single snapshot of files and folders. And that also means that when it comes time for us to publish our changes back based on the work we did with that revision, that that's published back to that single repository. And that's, as I said, what most of us have experienced, irregardless of what we call that checkout, whether it's a working copy or working space or review. We still had just one revision, and for all intents and purposes, we spoke to one master repository. So now Git and some other tools come along, using a different approach to the implementation of version control, one we could call either decentralized or, more often, distributed version control. With this model, the user doesn't get just one revision of the files and folders under control, but in fact gets a copy, a clone, if you will, of the whole repository. That means that they have all the history local to them in that copy, that clone. It allows us to communicate directly to that local repository. But it also means that there is no internal convention or idea of having a central point of truth, a main repository, if you will. Now, you know, in enterprises, we do need such a concept. We are going to have to pull things together. We need to have one single repository that we can go to for being able to take it through the formal testing process, and obviously to deploy it into various environments, including production. But to have that central or main repository is something that we have to impose upon the distributed tool. It is not inherently a part of it. In the general model, we each one have our own copies and can share them back and forth, but there is no concept of a single point of truth. Another way for us to understand the differences is to take at least a high-level look at the interaction in operations for the user and for the data. Taking the centralized approach, which is probably best represented by the open source tools CVS and Subversion, there is a central point of truth somewhere out there in the cloud. And its work begins off of the trunk, with potential branching off of that, and the latest version being head. The developer or end user will check out, again, a particular revision. Locally, then, they'll begin to make their changes, saving it to the file system along the way, each time replacing what was there before. At some point, they're ready to commit their changes, that is, to publish them back to the main repository. And along the way, they may also need to pull down, or want to pull down, the changes that other people have put into or published to the common repository. And that, in general, is the experience of an end user in dealing with a centralized tool. So let's take the experience that we just saw with a centralized tool and contrast it to what we'll be seeing with Git in Essentials Concepts 1 and 2. First of all, we said already that there is a main repository only by convention and not because it's required by the tool. But since enterprises work that way, let's think of the model that way. So in the main repository, the main branch is now called master, and we can branch off of it. And the user, or the end user, will get a copy of the whole repository via a clone operation. They'll keep up to date with changes that other people publish by fetching those changes locally and merging them together with the changes they've made locally. On the local repository, they have their own set of branches, as well as branches that are mirroring the branches that are up in the main repository. Locally, again, they can save their changes as they go along the way, but they additionally have the ability to move changes into another area, what we call the index, via an add command. That allows them to continue to work in what we call the working tree without having to impact what may be already set to to be able to be moved into the repository with the next commit. Once they're ready with those things that they put into the index for them to be committed, they'll be committed to the local repository, and that process can be repeated multiple times. At some point, when they've got their changes done locally, fetched and merged together the ones that other people have put in the main repository, they're ready to publish their changes to the main repository, and they'll do that via the push command. So what we see here is it's certainly a more complex environment, giving a few more moving pieces to repositories, most obviously. But it really doesn't have to be all that complex, and there are a lot of potential benefits to how Git approaches this, and that's what we're going to be examining in the session we have today, as well as the one you'll visit later. We said one of the fundamental purposes for version control was to be able to support and govern parallel development. As we said, we'll talk about the situation of needing to use branches for isolated lines of development later, but we do want to visit the issue of what to do about the situation when you and I want to modify the same file, and making sure that one of us just doesn't clobber or overwrite the work of the other. Again, there are basically two solutions that version control tools in general may use. The first is what's often called the copy, modify, merge. And the idea of that is that each of us gets a copy of the file that we want to modify, and we go about making our changes. The first person to be done posts those changes back up into the repository. With Git, that takes us committing that change and pushing it up to the main repository. That means that the second person is not going to be able to put their changes in until they reflect the modifications that have already been applied to the main repository. In Git, that means they'll have to fetch and merge them together with their own changes. And then they're going to be allowed to commit those changes and to push them up. And that is what we mean by merge, the copy, modify, merge approach. It allows two of us to work simultaneously on the same file. The second approach, often seen in some proprietary tools, is the idea of getting a lock, that is basically reserving the right to produce the next version of that file along a particular line of development or branch. In that approach, that single person has got the right to be able to make changes, and no one else can access that particular file in the repository to make modifications to it until that person either completes that work and commits the change, or they release the lock. Now, you can imagine, understanding what you already do about the decentralized or distributed approach, that the lock, modify, unlock is pretty hard to envision being implemented. Why? Because there's no central point of control that can monitor who's got a lock and prevent other people from doing things. Remember, for the most part, you're making commits, at least initially, in your own repository. So it just comes to being reasonable that the choice for Git is the first one, copy, modify, merge. That being said, we do have to be aware of where the other one would have applied and do the best we can with dealing with it. So best practices would say the lock, modify, unlock model is what we need when we don't have a tool to merge that particular type of file. In that case, we've got to be very careful. First of all, we could clobber somebody else's changes, or secondly, we have a productivity problem. Two people working, first one wins, the second one is either going to have to abandon their work or manually apply the changes the first one did, or abandon their work and manually reapply the changes they were just doing. Productivity. So while it can't be supported, we do have to consider that issue as we communicate and do development on objects that fit into the category that makes sense for doing locking. Let's look a little bit about exactly how Git does implement the copy, modify, merge model. So without spending too much time, because we're going to look at these operations in more detail as we spend time together today, we want to look at the high level of how Git implements the copy, modify, merge model. Well, to start out with, we said that a user is going to get a copy of the full repository via what we call the clone command. So both user A and user B have that repository local. That allows each of them to make their own changes and apply those or commit those to their local repositories. Subsequently, one of those two users is going to go ahead and push their changes up to the main repository. Now the main repository is up to date with user A, And when user B attempts to do the same thing, they're going to fail in pushing because they're going to be told they're out of date. They don't have the changes in the main repository that were applied by user A. And so they will have to fetch those changes down so that they're local to their local repository and merge those changes into their line of development, which they'll have in their local working tree, so that they can address any conflicts as well as test the combined results. Once they're satisfied with what's been merged together, they will commit those changes again to the local repository. And finally, they will be able to successfully push their changes, the ones that are now in combination with those originally posted by user A, to the main repository. And at some point, obviously, user A is going to need to fetch those changes down so that their local repository is in alignment with what the main repository now has. Now, we're going to spend more time in detail with that later, but I hope that gives you a big picture of how the copy, modify, merge model is implemented by Git. For some reason, it seems with version control, things come in pairs. And so we have two choices the tools have made with regards to how they store the data. Traditionally, tools have tended to go with a deltafied storage approach. So that's probably what you've experienced with your legacy tools. And that approach, if we look at what's saved when we commit modifications and additions to files, is just the changes themselves, not the full file that we changed. And basically the idea is that we can take those changes and apply it to the previous version in order to produce the latest version. Now in reality, no tool really actually only implements deltas for each change made along the way. Why? Because it would be abysmally slow in producing the latest version of a file that had changed a lot over history if it took building it up from each change along the way. So instead, there is some ability to gather those up at time. For example, with Subversion, it uses a skip delta format, in which by default it promises that no more than 4 deltas are required to produce any specific revision. And that means there's a gathering up of changes at different points in time. Well, that still doesn't mean that for the most part we're not storing deltas, and that's really what we want to contrast here. Many of those legacy tools, in fact most of them, are only keeping track of the files and folders that are modified when they're storing data, because they're dealing with only those pieces. Some, like Subversion, are keeping pointers to the other objects that are not being changed. The second approach is what we call snapshot storage. And in that particular model, what we're actually keeping is the full contents of the modified files and reference pointers to everything we don't change. So that basically the storage gives us a snapshot of that particular point in time as a result of the changes being applied with the commit that's associated with it. So this is the approach that Git utilizes, so that we have a snapshot of exactly what everything in our repository looked like, reflective of the changes of each single commit. Many of us happen to learn better visually, so let's take the concepts we just talked about with storage and look at it visually. So first we'll start out with a commit that applies the creation of 3 new files, A, B, and C. So we have the first version of each one of those. With the deltafied storage, when it comes to the fact that in the commit 2, we modify file A and file B, but not file C, what do we end up with? Well, we end up with just the delta, that is the set of changes for each of the files A and B. And for some tools, nothing indicating C. As with Subversion, as we indicated earlier, there would be a pointer to the original version of C. In commit 3 now, we modify files B and C. Again, what do we have? We have just the delta changes. What was it that we actually modified in producing the new version? And again, when it comes to A, it will depend on the tool whether we have a pointer back to the last version or whether we have no reference to it at all. At snapshot storage, what's the difference? Well, now in commit 2, we have the full file of A and B because they were modified, and we have a reference pointer to file C. And with commit 3, we have a full file for B and C because they were modified, and they're there in their entirety, and a pointer to file A. Hopefully, That makes you understand exactly what the differences are between the two models for storage. And you'll get a feeling for why that's important as we walk through the functionality of Git. Now, I don't want to spend time on each one of the bullet points on this slide, but I think at least a couple of things are worth calling out. First, we say it's inspired by BitKeeper and Monotone, probably more by the former than the latter. Why? Because of the third point, the fact that the Git project was initiated by Linus Torvalds, father of Linux. You see, BitKeeper's claim to fame for quite a long time was its use as the version control tool for the development of the Linux kernel. But at one point, a user in the open source community took it upon themselves to somewhat reverse engineer BitKeeper, with the obvious goal of being able to replace it with an open source alternative. And that, as you might expect, didn't go over well with the creators of BitKeeper, and so they changed the licensing as it impacted open source development. Well, that in turn aggravated Linus, who decided he can go off and create his own tool that fit his needs. And so, according to his own lore, him and a few friends went away for the weekend and created the foundation of Git as we experience it today. And that means its early development was really very much driven by what was going on with the Linux development and how it utilized the tool. In the last few years, that role has predominantly been taken by development of the Android operating system and the various applications that are being driven around it. And that's where the influence to the Git tool has come from. We can say it has strong support for nonlinear development. You don't really have to experience that when we talk about some things today. But that's not everybody's cup of tea anyway. If it is, it's a benefit. We will say that its design is simple. That may seem really confusing when you start to look at Git and feel like it's complex to master. That may still be true, but that doesn't mean that its underlying design isn't fairly simple, and I hope that'll come out as well. While version control itself is about history, you're not really here to have a history lesson, so I don't want to spend too much time here. I just want to point out that the original development of Git moved at a pretty good clip. April of 2005 is when Linus and his friends first got together to start working on Git. Not surprisingly, when he declared that something needed to be done to replace BitKeeper, several other projects also date back to that particular point in time. Tools like Mercurial and Bazaar. In any case, in the early stages, we see a very quick and frequent release of the tool. That's very reflective of getting key foundational functionality out at a pretty good clip along the way. What you see now is that development is taking longer, somewhere probably around 18 months between releases. And that's very indicative of the stage of the project, where things take longer to put out, where the roadmap is a little bit less detailed as to what would be the next things to accomplish. So if you compare it to Subversion, for example, things happened somewhat quicker at the beginning, but they've settled out to being much the same.
When you talk about an open source tool, it's difficult to gauge its use and the growth of its adoption. No one's receiving revenue for its use. Nowhere do you have to register to use it. No one has to admit their organization even utilizes it. Now, by anecdotal evidence, we know that Git has a significant market share of the version control arena, and every market analyst will attest to that. In addition, there are surveys like the one shown here that was conducted by the Eclipse community. Given that the responses would be somewhat skewed to open source use, since that's an open source community, it is still a solid indicator that Git use basically doubled in 2012. While we cannot give enterprise names, there are Fortune 500 companies with thousands of Git users today, with hundreds of companies either just beginning to use Git or evaluating it. It is no longer a bleeding edge tool, but rather a leading edge tool, the fastest growing version control tool today.
Since Git's initial primary use was around open source, it's kind of nice to understand some of the popular or well-known projects that are out there in open source that are utilizing Git. We've talked about two of the leaders with Android and Linux development, but others listed on this page include the GNOME and the Ruby on Rails projects that you may be familiar with. Again, attesting to the role and the position that Git now has in the version control marketplace, most particularly in open source. In an area like version control, there are some common terms And yet the meaning of those terms can vary quite widely from one version control tool to another. So before I start using some of those terms and you get lost because you understand them a different way, let's cover what those terms mean in reference to Git. First, repository. Well, I think most of us understand repository is that master library of all the files and folders that we've had over history and all the history that's gone along. The difference with a tool like Git, as we've already noted, is the fact there isn't one single point of history, but in fact each of us as end users have got a copy of that full history. So repositories are everywhere with regards to Git. That brings us to the second term of remote. Obviously for us as individual developers, most of the time we're going to be working off of a clone, that is a copy of another repository. And most frequently we call that repository from which we copied the remote. The folder or directory in which you can find the repository when you download it on your machine is going to be under .git. That'll include reference pointers, it'll include the objects themselves, and a lot of other things that we're going to look at in Essential Concepts 1. When we use the term path, that means the location of a file or of a directory or folder, which could be either in our repository or into our working tree. That is the area in which we're going to make changes or do builds from or view the code. Index is a different term. We looked at it a little bit when we looked at the operations of a decentralized model, and that is the staging area, an ability for us to isolate things that we're not ready yet to put exactly into the repository to commit them, but we also are a little bit beyond just modifying them here in our working tree. So we put them in an area in which we can assemble what we want to actually commit together into the repository. We've already alluded to what a working tree is, and that's the local copy that we have of files and directories that we're working on of a particular point out there in history along a branch from our cloned repository. One of the things we have to get used to is the fact that we don't have revisions numbers with Git. Now, most of our legacy tools applied revision numbers to a particular object, a file or folder, and established numbers starting with either 1 or 0 that would increment along each individual path or branch within that particular object. Subversion came along, and if you're acquainted with it, it changed that model a bit. And instead of looking at tracking of revisions at the individual object basis, instead began to look at revisioning from the whole of the repository as a commit modified that repository. But again, we had a sequential number then associated with each individual commit and the change set associated with it. Well, Git works kind of like that, except that it doesn't have that sequential revision number. Instead, it uses a SHA-1. It's a hash algorithm, and that's what we use to identify commit objects. And we'll use that same algorithm to identify other types of objects as well. That obviously brings us to the term object, and that really is all different types of objects that Git is using. And they are identified, as we've already indicated, by their SHA-1. And those objects could be anything from the commits to files to folders and other types of things. The last term on this particular page probably looks a little odd. First of all, we have that less than, greater than around the word type, and then in with ish. And we say it's an object or of the type that can be peeled to the corresponding type. What does that mean? Well, that means, for instance, that either we're telling you this is a commit, and that's what you have, or, for instance, we could give you the SHA-1, which obviously is a number we apply to that particular object. Or we're talking about looking at a folder, and instead we give you a branch, which is a folder. So the idea is there that we can work our way, whether we start with that object type, a branch or a folder, for example, or whether we point to some other kind of object that immediately refers us to a folder. I hope that makes some sense. We'll see it some more as we go along. A commit is not just the operation that takes to publish our set of changes into the repository, but within Git, it is also an object, which is that snapshot that we talked about of a particular point of time of our working tree, of our repository. indicating exactly what every file and folder that we have in a control look like as a result of applying changes. And it contains, most specifically, the actual files that were modified in their entirety, as well as reference pointers to the things that didn't change. When we look at the object that represents a file, we call that a blob. In reality, what it's actually got in it is just the contents of the file, and the names for files are reference pointers to those objects. The object that represents a directory is a tree, and it works much the same way, with a reference pointer being the part that has its name, and the tree being a list of what it contains. We wouldn't really be able to use most of our version control tools very well if we didn't have an ability to put a human meaningful name against a particular version of the things that we have under control. And that's the purpose of a tag. It marks a specific object. With Git, we have two different types of tags. One we call a lightweight tag. And that is really a situation where the only thing we have is a file that's a pointer to a particular commit. So it's immutable from that standpoint, and it also has no metadata of its own. The annotated tag, on the other hand, allows us to not only put a name to a pointer, but it also allows us to track information, who created it, when they created it, what they said about it, as well as then have the pointer to the actual commit object itself that we want to name. A branch, thankfully, is what we think of it as. It's a line of development. The implementation may be different, but its use and understanding is the same. By convention, when we create a new repository, whether we create one from nothing or whether we create it as a result of a clone operation, we're going to start out with an initial branch called the master. So you can relate it to what Subversion or CVS start out with, like trunk, or another example, clear case in its main. So by convention, that's the branch that's there. But note, by convention means it doesn't have to be there. And we'll get to that in essential concepts too. Finally, we have the term head. You may feel like you're familiar with that if you came from CVS or Subversion, but there is a difference here. Head is a pointer to what we currently have checked out, the branch that we have checked out. So it doesn't necessarily mean the latest version, although oftentimes we do mean it that way. Obviously, a tool like Git that's experiencing such great increase in popularity has a lot of great key features that attract people to it and make it as popular as it is. Now, I don't want to belabor that point by going through each one of these bullets in great detail, but I do think it's important to call out a few of them. First, speed. That's probably something that people will initially feel with Git. Now, a lot of that comes from the fact that, for the most part, we're often working totally within our own local machine. We're not having to wait for bits and bytes to move across a wide area network to some remote machine inside the cloud. And so, operations like merge, for example, are able to exchange information fairly rapidly because we're on the same box. There is also a carryover to when we do have to communicate with that remote box, but we'll look at that later. Also, because we do have our own local repository, it really allows the developer the ability to commit very early and commit often. And that's really what we would like to do if you think about development. We like to work in small chunks with the ability to baseline that we can move back to as well as examine as we move forward. And the important thing here, and we'll stress it several times in our time together, is the fact that how we do things initially doesn't drive what we ultimately share with the broader user community later when we put it up in the remote repository. Talk about easy merging, and that's commonly one of the other things that's called about a Git when people talk about its benefits and its attractiveness. And part of that comes from having multiple strategies. But the key to that is, for the most part, letting Git determine which of those multiple strategies is appropriate for a particular scenario that we provided. You may become smart enough to try to override those, but for the most part, Git's smarter than you, at least now. But we'll talk about those strategies when we get to essential concepts too. The staging area is a very unique thing. The ability to have not just the copy that we're working on in isolation from what's in the repository, but this other area where we kind of put things, changes into place that are almost ready to commit, and yet not quite, but yet we don't want to modify them with other ongoing things in our working area. We'll also find that ability for each commit to relate itself to where it is in structure and where it is in history as a unique capability of a tool like Git. And finally, while it may be very frightening to think about bringing down a whole repository on your own machine when you want to work and being able to communicate with that way, you'll find that there are particular reasons in Git's design that make it very efficient in doing that, one of those being the way that it actually stores the objects. And we'll look some at that in Essential Concepts 1 in just a bit. One of the great blessings of utilizing an open source tool is the fact that because it's open source, developers who like to work in a particular platform or in a particular environment have the ability to produce their own client to work in that environment and share it with us. And so we find a myriad of different clients available to us so that you can work where you'd like to work, whether that's purely on the operating system platform or whether that's tied tightly into your integrated development environments. So here you can see some, not all, of the different clients that may be available for you to utilize and how you relate to Git and how you work it into your normal development. The only one that I'd really like to call out is under web applications. It's the one called Garrett. Now, as a base, it's really about code review and automating that process, utilizing the fact that we have a Git repository. But it also provides us some capabilities around being able to provide access control on particular paths, as well as being able to prevent modifications of that central point of truth. So we'll look about that in a little bit more later for the purposes of doing code review. And we'll see how a tool like that can really help us implement Git in the way that enterprises probably most want to utilize it. Well, hopefully that wasn't too painful if you knew a lot about Git already, or at least you were able to skip forward. But now it's time for us actually to start to learn more about the essential concepts of how we're going to utilize Git on a day-to-day basis.